What's going on, everybody? This is HBT, Harry Bernard Taylor from the Straight Up Wrestling Show. I'm with my man, Danny Paris, and we're going to talk about a legend that a lot of people talk about out here. A lot of people know of him. I mean, he is a legend that a lot of the young people that's getting into wrestling or been watching wrestling for a little while, they are interested in this man. This man's name is Lou Thesz, probably one of the greatest wrestlers in the world, I mean, ever. If not number one. So I'm talking to Danny Paris, historian Danny Paris, good friend of Chris and Harry Taylor, and pretty much part of the Straight Up Wrestling Show. So Danny, let's talk about Lou Thesz a little bit.
Lou Thesz came along in the era of the 1930s, Harry, and by this point in time, your territories were starting to open up. There weren't always territories everywhere. They were opened up in various pockets of the country. And the more you, by as all said and done, at the climax, you had 40.
Okay.
Territories. Or 40 or 50, but anyway.
No, that was a good bit back. That was a good bit back so then, yeah, though.
Yeah, and at this point in time, there might have been about half that.
Okay.
But because the country hadn't expanded. And bear in mind, this is still pre-television.
Okay.
You know, TV did not hit anywhere till 1946.
Right.
And so, Thesz came along in the Midwest. I think he was in St. Louis, where he originally came from. And the groups out there running, there was an NWA, but it was not the National Wrestling Alliance.
Okay. That's one thing.
It was called
National
Wrestling Association.
Yes. I remember that.
And there was a Midwest Wrestling Association as well.
Okay.
Out there too. And later on, the National Wrestling Association merged with the National Wrestling Alliance.
Oh, okay.
The lineage of that goes back to the association, not the alliance. So, Thesz's father was a shoemaker, Martin Thesz.
Okay.
He became involved with the promotions, as did, what's his name, he was the former president of the NWA. I can't think of his name.
Bob Gaggle?
Sam Muchnick.
Yeah, Sam Muchnick. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, Sam Much was very big in that era, too. And they relied so much heavily back then on newspaper.
Right.
Newspaper advertised the show. The next day, they'd give the results of the show. I'm sure there was something to do with radio, but paper, newspaper was probably... Newspaper back then was probably as big as the internet is today.
Okay, yeah, that's true. Yeah.
I would say. And so Thesz, at age 21, went on to capture his first NWA World Heavyweight title. Now, he is arguably, some people say Tommy Rich was the youngest world champion. I would say Thesz was.
Yeah, I think Tommy Rich was basically, they say he was 21, but I think he was actually 22. What city did he capture that title in? Can you remember? I mean, can you recall that? What city did he capture it in?
Oh, gosh, I have no idea. I know that once they started picking up momentum and you had other promoters, they were different people were laying claims to different belts.
Right.
And, you know, there was like five different people claiming to be world champion. So what he did, they met with the association to do unification matches, but whoever would come out of that would wind up having to defend in that old territory.
Oh, okay.
But now, I'll give you some trivia on, because we do a lot of independent stuff, you and I, and Chris, the MWA, the Midwest group, was basically a farm system.
Okay.
Promotion. And it wasn't the only one of its kind either. Back then, if you started to say if you wanted to go to that NWA, where they had them in the Coliseums and the Civic Centers and the places like that. You started with the MWA Midwest.
Right.
I mean, you'd wrestle in the National Guard armories, or there was even some places where they, like Charlotte, Jim Crockett Sr. had a place in Gastonia where it was a restaurant / arena.
Oh, okay. Wow.
They served hot supper food in the evening, and about every Wednesday night they had the matches in there.
Oh, okay.
And so the rest of the time it's a restaurant. That was one of his earliest buildings, so that sounds kind of crazy how they'd set stuff up. So you would start with that group. And once they start scouting you, and sometimes a lot of people back then started at like the age of 16. I've even heard tell people start and turn pro at the age of 14.
Okay, wow.
So at that time, because there's probably different labor laws in effect, you know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
And so anyhow, they later on, what it was, that was the developmental system. That's what I was trying to say. But they didn't know such a term back then, I don't think.
Okay, yeah. Let me ask you, stop just 1 second. Hold that thought. What year was that? Well, when he won the title, what year? I know he was 21, but what year was that?
It had to be in the 40s.
Yeah, okay.
I don't have the actual...
1946 or something like that, I think. I'm trying to think of my knowledge of him, but I could be wrong on that. But, okay, go ahead.
And he pretty much, by the time the late 60s rolled around, about 68 or 69, he was still around, but by that point it was Gene Kaniski who had the belt.
Right.
But so, of the modern...
Hold on, Danny, hold on. I'm sorry. I cut you down for just a second. I made a mistake here. Okay, go ahead and speak. I'm sorry. You said in the late 60s, you say by the late 60s, Gene Kaniski had the belt, right?
National Wrestling Alliance.
Yes.
And they feuded off and on, too. Thez was prominent. I don't have my notes or nothing from me about who all he feuded with and this and that and the other, but he was prominent in two things. At that point in time, prior to the late 50s, or mid-50s or so, there was different groups called different things, but the people that would form the AWA, American Wrestling Association, were lobbying. They were wanting Vern Gagne to get the belt.
Oh, yeah.
And the NWA people were arguing against it. So the backers behind what was the Midwest Coalition formed an AWA. They had a match where somewhere there was a disputed finish between Thez and Gagne.
Okay.
And bear in mind, both of these guys are going to the match babyface.
Okay, but right.
There's a dispute, and they come out of it, babyface. Unheard of, isn't it?
Oh, yes.
So, by this point, there is TV.
Right.
And somewhere, one week on TV, they announced that they're no longer a part of the National Wrestling Alliance, that they were recognizing Vern Gagne, their champion, and their new group would be called the American Wrestling Association.
Okay.
So that's how they pulled out. And now that would be kind of like, I don't know if you remember when World Class pulled out of the NWA and just became World Class on its own.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. Just tried to survive on its own. That would be about what that was the equivalent of.
Oh, okay.
Except for the AWA was much stronger. And they were able to survive.
Right.
And also they were... Later on, they were still on friendly terms with the NWA because they did not invade one another's space and try to raid talent and all that stuff. I mean, they stayed where they were, and the NWA stayed where they were. So, Thez was instrumental indirectly in the formation of the National Wrestling Alliance.
Okay.
Now, later on, in 1963, he was responsible for the formation of what Capital Sports we call today WWE. He would be responsible for the formation of the WWF.
Okay.
A lot of people were wanting him to drop, get the belt off Buddy Rogers.
Right.
Who was then the NWA World Champion. And the reason why Buddy Rogers was wanting to defend that belt all over up north in the middle, and well, like Ohio, Illinois, anywhere except for the southeast.
Right.
From like Texas, all the way through Carolina, Virginia, Georgia, and all those places. So Dez was defending, was willing to defend it anywhere and everywhere.
Right. Yeah, Luke Dez, yeah, hold that thought. But yeah, Luke Dez, it was 1939 when he won his first National Wrestling Association World Championship. So he won that in 39, and he won it again. He defeated he won it again in 1948, defeating Bill Longson. In 1939, I'm not sure who he defeated. Somebody with the Everett Marshall, December 29th, 1937, he defeated Everett Marshall for the National Wrestling Association World Championship. Now, the National Wrestling Alliance, that's the one I was thinking about. And he won that in 1948. So
it was actually
I think when they changed it over, I guess. When they formed together.
That was actually the first year that NWA National Wrestling Alliance was born.
Yes, right.
So, but you hear tell of the NWA going back to the turn of the century, that is not true.
Right.
So, but nonetheless, I mean, they had, he went in there with Rogers with the agreements of, you know, there was an argument about who was going to win the match, and they basically told him, we can do this the hard way or the easy way.
Oh, wow.
In other words, you can put me over clean, or I'll shoot on you and get the belt.
Oh, okay.
That type of thing was still happening, too, from time to time, but not often. So Rogers said, we'll just do business. And when they had the match, Capital Sports later on recognized Rogers as world champion. And of the native vein, they recognized Dez as champion.
Oh, okay.
So,
wow.
Anyhow, so Dez is indirect due to the fact that you had three different governing companies.
Okay.
And of course, later on, I guess it was the 50s when that WWA in California came across.
Right.
I would say that was not around that same time.
Okay.
But so you did have three governing bodies everywhere, and he was willing to, I'm going to say this because a lot of people just flat out ignore this part. All world champions went to Japan.
Right.
WWF, AWA, NWA, but great parts of Europe, like England and France and Austria and Germany, these were different. They had no association with the National Wrestling Alliance.
Okay.
Or WWF or AWA or none of it. But, however, he was one of the few that agreed to go into Europe and defend the belt in non-regulated promotions.
Okay.
And it made it. And this was pretty well acknowledged. You know, he went to Germany. He went to wherever, so it made it a true world championship.
Yeah, no doubt. Man, that's even more than what Flair did. You know, go ahead.
Yeah. Out of his six reigns, he was probably the only world champion to ever go over there.
Okay.
So, wow. I mean, and so that was that. And, you know, so, but he had the respect of everybody and anybody. Later on, lots of people don't realize not only was he a competitor, he was a promoter.
Right.
In the late 70s, he opened up a group in Nashville called the Universal Wrestling Alliance.
Mm-hmm.
And they went head-to-head with Nick Gulas's NWA.
Oh, okay.
In Nashville. Both groups had TV, too. So that lasted a little while. And that was prior to, I guess he quit running, and then Jerry Jarrett split off with Gulas to go to the War of Tennessee. So it was, he has a lot of places in history and what have you. And a lot of times they would do stuff like, I'm sure you've heard, Dale, like occasionally they'd bring in Joe Louis as a referee or something.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm.
Big title matches, big grudge matches. Well, later on, after he didn't have the belt, he was brought into to referee world title matches, you know, the NWA title matches.
Right.
In Mexico, I think the year was 1976, there was a group also called UWA. Didn't have nothing to do with the Nashville promotion. The Universal Wrestling Alliance out there, he was recognized as their first world champion. And he can you imagine him trying to, but he wasn't doing the flying stuff. He was just doing his style, but he was still quite popular.
Right.
And later on, he dropped that belt to, you might want to Google this name because I do know it, El Canek.
Oh, yeah, I know.
Was the first world. Right. First world champion in Mexico after this.
Oh, yeah.
And I've even tried to find the matches of his matches in Mexico, and I cannot find them on YouTube, unfortunately.
Wow.
But
I don't think I ever... I know he's very popular, Mexican wrestler, but, yeah, I don't think I've ever saw a match of El Canek's. Not one.
Well, I'll tell you this. Well, you're probably going to hang up the phone and realize this later when you get a chance this evening. Canek was one of the first people to beat Andre the Giant.
Oh, wow. Man.
Yeah. You know, this the loss that he had to Hogan was not his first loss.
Oh, I definitely know that. I know Hogan won his first loss. Definitely know that.
Yeah, I think he even lost to Inoki in Japan.
Who, Andre did?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He might have had, I don't know how many losses he had prior to the Hogan loss, but they were all internationally done. Nobody would terribly acknowledge them.
Right.
But anyway, but Thez was way ahead of the game, and I want to explain something, too, about his style. His style was a working style, but it was a lot of mat stuff and a lot of submission stuff. And I was trying to think of the finishing move, but I do know it now. Tommy Rich used it again. There was the Luthez press. Just kind of like a vertical body press.
Right.
But for prior to that, he really didn't have finishing holds.
Oh, okay.
But when he just beat you, he was just outsmarting you, out-wrestling you.
Right.
And if you were an inferior opponent to him, a guy that could give up with him, bear in mind, matches back then with a world title were 2 out of 3 falls. And if he felt like you were trying to make him look bad, he would beat you in 2 falls straight.
Right.
And can you imagine what that does to your challenger later? You know, either he's going to leave the territory or he's going to build himself all the way back up.
True.
I mean, shoot. I mean, that could damage the heck out of your challenger.
No doubt.
In your local promotion.
That's true.
So, you know, that would be the prominent thing. And for those of you who do like YouTube, I will say this, if you want to Google this and talk about a match that's rough and it's only a few minutes, there is a match out there on YouTube with Thez and Johnny Valentine.
Oh, it is?
Yeah, wow. It's from Florida. Gordon Sully doing the commentary.
Was it in the 70s? Oh, 60s.
Yes.
Oh, in the 70s, okay.
Thez and Johnny Valentine.
Oh, wow.
And if some people might consider it kind of boring, it's kind of slow-paced, but It's not boring to me just because, well, they both knew what they were doing. The crowd's really into it. You know, wow, just, I don't know. But what I was going to say about his style is his style was a professional style. but it threw back to the late 1920s style too, because prior to that, this modern stuff that we see today with a lot of arm drags and hip tosses and pile drivers and all this other stuff wasn't really around a lot.
Right.
Prior to that, and he was managed by Ed Strangle Lewis throughout his whole career.
Right.
Who was an early world champion.
Oh, yeah.
And I think he was a two-time champion. But prior to that, what the style was,
yeah,
and trust me, I tried to research this, and there is a version of it out there. And that was done a lot of
Ed Strangler Lewis was American world champion, AWA champion for 2 years. Two times, I'm sorry, not 2 years. Two-time AWA world champion, I know that.
That's not though considered the American Wrestling Association.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's what we consider American Wrestling Alliance.
Well, no, it said
one of the claimants.
American Wrestling Association, Boston.
Okay, that's Paul Bowser's group.
Yeah, okay, that was, he was the world champion there two times. I don't think he held the world championship anywhere else. I could be wrong on that, but I think that's the only... And that was just out of Boston. That's the only considered world championship that he held. And I know he held the Florida Heavyweight Championship once or twice or something like that.
Yeah. One thing that caused him to end his career, I don't know when he passed away, but...
Which one, Thez?
Thez hadn't been gone long, but...
Lewis, 66?
Suffered from glaucoma.
Yeah, 1966, I think, something like that.
1966?
Yes.
Well, back then they had a lot of trouble cleaning the mats.
Right. Oh, wow. Okay.
And he got blind from glaucoma, and I think the complications from that caused him to die.
Oh, wow.
And later on, they pretty much changed the way they cleaned those mats, while bleaching them and stuff.
Oh, okay.
Probably because you're going in and out of a lot of arenas where it's dirt floor, parking lot, and you know, now today's time, you still walk through some of that, but a lot of times you're going through a paved parking lot or asphalt parking lot or what have you, so chances of you getting that in is bad. But the predecessor to his style is called catch pro wrestling.
Okay.
I'm going to explain that in two sentences what that is. Catch was almost, it was at one time an Olympic sport. They decided not to do it later, and they just broke it up. Catch was consisted of freestyle, which is NCAA wrestling.
Yeah.
And Greco-Roman wrestling.
Right.
Which is the style, you know, that we've seen Jeff Blatnick popularize, and Baumgartner, and... I can't think of the guy's name from Russia who won, like, gold belts. And it, can't think of his name. But anyway, it was big. And so what they did with catch, they combined Greco-Roman and freestyle with submission rules with jiu-jitsu.
Okay.
That was your catch pro wrestling.
Okay.
But due to the injury rates and all this and that and the other, and like if you wanted to put two guys together and run around a horn for 17 dates, you couldn't probably do it back then because it was a lot of shooting.
Right.
But in working matches, you could. So he was, by the time he got into it, it was definitely a work sport, but he didn't know the lineage from catch pro wrestling, and they wanted people to have that because if a guy went in the ring and tried to crisscross a guy and get a belt when he wasn't supposed to, then he was trained enough, well enough to cut you off and shoot on you and put a stop to that.
You're not talking about George Hackenschmidt, are you?
Oh yeah, but Hackenschmidt and Frank Gotch are definitely the forerunners of catch wrestling.
Yeah. Okay.
They were in the early 1900s.
Yeah, exactly.
I would say the majority the majority of those made it prior to the 20s were shoots.
Yeah.
Basically.
Yeah. Yeah, because it said, what's the name?
But they've still done 2 out of 3 falls.
And, oh, right.
And actually here, I think it's Humboldt, Iowa. They do a tournament every year out there in honor of Gotch. But you go in those rules. You go under those rules.
Oh, right. Okay.
And,
wow.
And I don't think they'll allow fists, but they can. You can hit with an open palm. You can hit with a knee. You can probably choke somebody out. You can. It almost looks like was MMA style wrestling, but it's not the same thing.
Okay.
It's totally not the same thing. It's not. It's totally different. I don't see that ever catching on a national basis again.
Mm-hmm.
Because what is, you're being a boxing expert pretty much on this stuff. Let me ask you this: in the shoot situation, how many boxing pro matches can a guy have in a year?
A pro, four or five. I mean, it depends. Like, say, if you have the world title and you go on a tough match, they'll make you wait sometimes 6 months, anywhere from 4 to 6 months before you defend again. So now it's like 5 months. You can do five. You could do up to six as long as now they go by rounds. Long as you're doing like 4 round matches. If you're doing 4 round matches, you can do the 6 to 8. If you're doing like eight round, you can do like 6 of them. And then if you're doing 12 rounds, I think they limit you to like 4 a year.
Because I know George Foreman matches on his comeback trail, not all of them were 10 or 12 rounds.
No, they wasn't. Because he started off with 4 when he came back.
Well, there were giveaway matches where he could hope to win himself enough matches to get in contention.
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, but, anyway, that's another thing. It was so popular that they needed these guys to where they could do a full-time schedule.
Okay.
So Thea's more or less was rivaled with Kaninsky, Buddy Rogers. By the way, he did not end. I'm going to plug his book. It's called Hooker. You said it was available on Kindle.
Yeah, Kindle. You get it for $9.99 and it's $100 paperback. So, I mean,
yeah,
to get that thing in reprint, you're going to have to pay some money for it. So, yeah, he's definitely legendary, and he's definitely sought after to, you know, for people, you know, who want to be historians or people that want to know a lot of the history of pro wrestling. I mean, you definitely want to check out Luthez, and I mean, you're going to pay for it, to tell you the truth. So,
you know, I got my copy somewhere around 1990.
Oh, okay.
And I didn't pay no $100 for it.
Right.
So, but I mean, I didn't pay half of that. I think I paid $30 for it. So.
Okay.
And shortly after I got mine, it went out of print.
Wow.
So.
Well, I tell you what, if anybody finds that thing in a Goodwill or somewhere, or a thrift store, I mean, you found a gem. So definitely hang on to it, and you know, and hold on to it, and because you found something special if you find a copy of that book.
Harry, I do want to elaborate on something that he tells in his book. It's just to relate with today versus yesterday. You know, how you can get in your car to go to the matches. And on every street corner, there's a place to eat. There's a McDonald's, there's an Arby's, there's a Steak and Shake. There's all kind of places to go. Well, in those days, they would travel like 4 per vehicle, and it was a lot of driving, no flying. And what they would do, they would hit a mom-and-pop grocery store and get what's a bologna blowout.
Right.
I mean, they'd get a pound of bologna, pound of ham, whatever, the mayonnaise, the cheese, put it in a cooler, the beer and your loaf of bread or two. And that's where they ate to and from. Or they'd stop at a produce place and buy a bunch of perishables that they could still put in there as well. If they didn't do that, when they were driving. I'm about to outdate myself because I don't know how to compare it. I know back in the 70s, you remember the TV show Alice?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Linda Lavin.
Yes.
Was the star.
Right.
Well, anyway, in those days, too, if you were driving all across, you would have a lot of mom-and-pop cafeterias like that. But they would close at like 9 p.m.
Oh, yeah.
So if you're on the road and you stop, you don't have, that's your only three means of getting your food with you.
Right.
Otherwise, there wasn't even a Waffle House back in those days.
Oh, heck no.
And you pretty well had to get your gas, fill it up before you got to the arena. Because if you were driving again all night, you make sure you're on full tank while you're driving home on the road in the middle of the night. I don't know about the rock and R&B artists, but I do know back in the days of Hank Williams Sr. and Loretta Lynn, God rest her soul, just recently passed. They did the same thing, driving the roads the same way.
Right.
Eating in the cars and eating in the tour buses and stuff of that nature. And they just had to make it the best way they could. It's a far cry from glamorous. And Thez's dad, by the way, Martin Thez, he was instrumental in helping putting the association and the National Wrestling Alliance together as one. I think that first started off with MWA and NWA and then NWA and NWA.
Right.
But he was a shoemaker in St. Louis area. And a lot of the guys, as they came to him and their boots were getting all messed up and they were, tearing apart or what have you, he would redo your boots, redye them black, and reseal them really whole. Or you could just order a brand new set of boots from them. And those boots, by the way, I will tell you this, because you probably might understand what I'm talking about, because not many people see them today. Do you remember the kind of Jack Briscoe used to wear? They were kind of like a little above. They weren't what you'd call high-top tennis shoes, but they're a little bit taller than that.
Okay.
They're black, and that's the kind everybody wore back then.
Right.
Later on, these boots that came up taller than that were made later, and some people will know, why do they go up so high? They're there to protect your ankles.
Oh, yeah.
And your shins and your stuff of that nature, because if you ever turn an ankle and you do have a high-top shoe like that on there, that high-top, a lot of times, will probably keep you from breaking your ankle.
No doubt. I mean, so that's the reason why it was always, it was always smart for a basketball player to wear high tops, even if you're out playing on the playground. I've seen too many people. My brother used to sometimes play without wearing high tops, and I mean, he would mess his ankle up. And there's a lot of other people I used to see. I've seen NBA pro games where guys was not wearing high tops, and it wasn't good. I mean, it would mess your ankle up. But I think now they have it. Now I think it's regulation where you have to wear a high top sneaker to play in the NBA. So I definitely understand what you're talking about because that's one thing I used to think of when I used to watch wrestling back in the day. I used to see it in the magazines and see old film of old wrestling, and I saw the wrestlers and they would wear those tight boots. I said, I figured that's the reason they wore that, because they had to protect their ankles. So yeah, I understand what you're saying on that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if he made the more modern boots or not, but the kind I'm talking about earlier, that Thez and Briscoe and others like that wore, he made those. Martin Thez.
Oh, he did. Okay.
And I don't even think I've ever seen a photo of that man, but But he had a lot of, and he helped with the promotion later on, St. Louis. So, you know, but, and you know, I'm going to say something else, too, that a lot of people don't get. Luther is, in defending the World Heavyweight title, some people might want to say, well, was he a good guy or was he a bad guy? Well, he was a good guy.
Right.
But he was a different kind of good guy. I can even say that Johnny Weaver got title shots to him in the Carolinas. But anyway, in those cases there, he would come out and shake hands with the guy. They might even throw punches a time or two in the match. But if they had your heel challengers and for him, he was a straight good guy.
Oh, okay.
But however, for the most part, he was able to take on good guys and bad guys, but only once that I know of, and that was in Nashville. I don't know who that was, Coolis or Lawler or Jared or who, but only once did he ever totally turn heel. But it wasn't for his own person, for his own personal group. But,
oh, okay.
But for the most part, he was always a good guy. Because I've even got footage here at home where he is wrestling Vern on Minnesota TV. And, yeah, they do throw a few punches and kicks in there, but not a lot. And they wind up trading falls and go to an hour draw.
Oh, wow.
And that's not a – you can follow YouTube and find it. I don't know, but – he was one, and see, some people say, well, you know what, Flair was a heel champion, this and that. You know, well, Gene Kaniski was too.
Right.
And Briscoe, however, was kind of the same mold as far as defending the belt against good guys and bad guys.
Right.
So it was, but he didn't ever totally turn heel.
Right, exactly.
So it just made it a complete different dynamic. I mean, there was such a situation back then to put the realism behind it. At one match I had in Florida one time, Tim Woods challenged Briscoe for the belt. And if you threw a punch in the match, you were disqualified.
Oh, wow.
any type of rule breaking or stretching the rules was a DQ.
Oh, okay.
And I'm sure they had those type of matches too from time to time.
No doubt.
And he did come out of retirement. God, I can't remember what year. Age 74, he came out of retirement for a match. I think it was New Japan Pro Wrestling.
Oh, wow.
And he did wrestle a 5.5 minute match. Age 74, he lost to Masachono.
Okay. Okay.
And do you know, I wouldn't want to ask or wouldn't want to privy to know, nobody knows the amount of money he got paid for that match.
Oh, okay. Okay. No. I hope it was good. I hope it was good.
Yeah, it was a 5 minute, 30 second match. He put Chono over. And it was a decent match for his age. And his reasoning behind it was, later on, he said, you know, I had no business going in there. And I think his wife is still alive there. Her name's Charlie Theus. I think she's still living in Virginia. But anyway, he said at the time, he said, they offered me a pretty good amount of money, enough to where I knew that if I were to pass away, my wife would have enough money to live on after I'm gone.
Oh, wow. Wow.
So that's what his reasoning behind that was. He said, yeah, I'll take it because I don't want to have to worry about me being gone and her having financial problems.
Yeah, I understand that. Yeah.
And by the way, I was going to say this too, the pay scale was different. Back then, I think a lot of places played by the night.
Right.
Some places paid by the week. I'll give you a quick thing too. Frank Gotch, who I was talking about earlier, he wrestled from the late 1800s to maybe 1910, maybe, or something. But off the money that Frank made enough money for not only his children and grandchildren to live off of, but his great-grandchildren are living off the money that he made of
Frank
made
Gotch?
A living at.
Who?
Which? Yeah, it's still in the bank. Money's still in the bank.
Oh, wow.
And so I don't know how you explain that other than he probably, man, I don't know. The money they made back then was different than they made back well, now. I mean, now it's contracted in Hawaii, but when you went to territories, and territories didn't usually have contracts.
Right.
Nothing whatsoever, contrary to what anybody wants to tell you. But however, for him to make that kind of money and that money still be turning over long after he's gone, he had to be worth, I would say at the time it wasn't $1 million, but as time progressed and they, what do? They look at your estate or whatever, or what the money is in the bank, and they say, hey, that money in 1910 is, well, it might be $1,000, but they upgrade it to where they say, hey, that's not worth $1,000, that's worth $10,000.
Yeah.
I don't know how you explain that, but.
yeah, inflation. Yeah, they adjusted for inflation.
Yeah. Or,
plus, that money was
off. Yeah, that or the exchange rate, one of the two.
Yeah, so, it made, that money was worth a lot more than what it is now, so. But yeah.
Yeah.
excuse me.
It was, and like I say, some people paid by the night, some people paid by the week. I mean, because like I say, if he came in to defend the belt in the Mid-Atlantic area and he was here only two nights, then he had to turn around and go to somewhere else for three nights. By that, those two nights were over with, he was going to get his two nights pay.
Okay.
I had to get, but locally, if you're on the circuit here, you probably got paid by the week.
Okay. Well, we're going to wrap it up, Danny. Let's see. But before we wrap it up, I want to ask you a couple things about Thez. What you think? I mean, where would you rank Thez as a world champion? I mean, there's a lot if you go all the way back in the day. But as a world champion, where would you rank him? And I mean, you know, I know he wasn't a modern day champion. And then if you go back to the old days, you got to think about people like Jim Lundos, Gotch, Ed Strangler Lewis. And, you know, all those, people like that who won world titles, and that was legendary. But where would you rank Luthes?
Top five.
Okay. Yeah, that's... that's fair. I would say that's very, very fair as far as best champions ever.
He'd done more for... like I said, when he went internationally touring... And the papers, you know, there was Associated Press back then. And they would say, hey, you know, he just came through to defend his belt in France and blah, blah, blah. Well, Hogan, when he was in the 80s, he brought the visibility way up.
Right.
From what it was already. But in those days there, the 30s and 40s, you know, and the Associated Press would say, well, you know, he just was over in England or Spain or France or whatever. Well, he brought it up to where I would say it was just recognized as a world title in America and Japan.
Right.
But once he was going all over the place, it made it a true recognized world title.
Yeah. Well, Flair went more than just Japan. Flair went to a lot of different places. Hogan's title reign, I wouldn't even call that a world championship as far as WWE, because I don't even remember, WWF, I don't remember Hogan defending that title in Japan. Now, he went to Japan when he was with the AWA, he would go to Japan, but he never won a world title there. But the WWF, he never defended that title outside of the eastern part of the United States and some parts of the western United States as far as I remember. But yeah, he never
actually. I can recall one or two title matches he did outside.
Yeah, but I think he did. But they definitely didn't have a working relationship with New Japan. That was NWA. I think he did. I think maybe he did it with Baba's Association. All Japan. I'm not sure, but he definitely. That definitely. I wouldn't consider that the real world championship. That's the reason when Ric Flair went over there, they called it the real world championship, world belt, because Ric Flair had defended, you know, he would go to He would go to Japan. He would go to Australia. He went to Puerto. You know, he would go to Puerto Rico. He went down to Dominican Republic. He went to a lot of different areas of the world to defend the title. I mean, I don't think he went to as many places as Luke Thiers. I think he went to Germany or something like that. I don't think he went to France and places like that. But Luke Thiers probably beat Flair on that. But Flair was really the last real world champion. Him and Harley Race, and I guess you could say Jack Briscoe too went to some places overseas. But him and Harley Race. But Ric Flair went to probably just as many places as anybody outside of Luke Thiers. It had to be Ric Flair. So, but yeah, very interesting. And man, yeah, we're gonna go ahead and wrap this session up. So appreciate everybody joining in. Excuse me. And we're gonna try to get to some more old classics. And you know, with my man Danny Paris, I think this is a very good documentary, very good retrospect of Luthea's career. And Danny, anything else before we go, man?
Harry, I just want to plug one thing, and it's due to the fact some people want to say, "Well, where can I find footage of this stuff?" Blah blah blah, blah. Things like that. And YouTube, there's a thing called Icons of Pro Wrestling.
All right, and all right.
Icons of Pro Wrestling aired on a wrestling channel in Canada, and it'll give you a 30-minute program showing Thiers where he, you know, his matches were here, there, the other. Not all his matches were certainly recorded. I mean, by no means. But this can show you enough. You can get a good 5 or 6 matches, a glance, to see what it was and what it was like and what have you. And, you know, Icons will show you different people you can pull up, like the Sheik, people like that, where people say, "Well, I remember that name, you know, I don't see what he did, this and that." And that'll back history up a lot of times.
Oh, yeah, oh, yeah.
Because it was certainly more different back then than it is today, or even in the 80s. I mean, there was a lot of legitimacy built toward that up until, you know, and I guess by 86 or so, that's when you quit having world champions go all over the place and defend their belts all over the well, no, you still had the AWA was in Japan some, and NWA in Japan some, but at one time, the National Wrestling Alliance world champion defended everywhere you could get him. I mean,
oh, yeah.
New Zealand and Australia, Hawaii, which I consider Hawaii part of the U.S., but it's different. Japan.
Even Puerto Rico, I mean, it's different,
it,
but it's
it
in
added
the U.S.
More to the,
I mean, it, Puerto Rico
to the
is
prestige.
Yeah, that's true. Puerto Rico is a U.S. Territory, but yeah, they defended in Puerto Rico. So yeah, but
it's a Providence.
Yeah, exactly. All right, but yeah, that's basically it. Like I say, man, appreciate everybody tuning in and checking us out. And if you're on YouTube, hit that like, share, subscribe, hit that notification bell so you know when we're coming on for times like this. If you're on Facebook, hit that like, share, join. And if you're on Twitter, hit that like, share, tweet, and retweet. And if you're checking this thing out on Twitch, do the same thing that you do on YouTube. Like, share, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. But Danny Paris, man, I'm going to have to let this thing in. I'm going to have to let it go. I'm getting kind of like, my throat is kind of bothering me a little bit. I apologize to anybody that's listening to that. But yeah, kind of like got choked up a little bit. But yeah, we're going to let this thing, we're going to end this session. But man, you know, we talked about Luke Thiers for like 50 minutes, and then we threw in a few other greats Danny reached out and talked about. So man, definitely check it out and check out the career of Luke Thiers. Check out some of his matches on YouTube or wherever you can find them. And if you can find that book, Hooked, definitely get a hold of that. All right. Well, Danny Paris.
And Harry, real quick, if you study the world title reigns, I will say this. There are a few that were unofficially switched that history does not acknowledge.
Okay.
Puerto Rico has where they switched it to NWA twice. That does not acknowledge that it happened, but they're not recognized world champions. And then Harley Race and Flair once were in New Zealand, and unofficially, I forgot how they did it. I think it was Race won the belt on a Saturday and lost it the next night to Flair.
Okay.
They did that for the New Zealand promotion without the blessing of the NWA.
Oh, wow.
So if anybody ever asks you, is Harley Race a 7-time world champion? No, he's an 8-time world champion.
Oh, okay. Okay, wow. All right.
But he only had the belt for like 24 hours. But they did that to help pop the
crowd.
The territory.
Yeah, yeah. I've heard something about that, and I think he did the same thing with one of the Von Erichs. I think him and Kerry did something like that. I'm not sure.
I know that Kerry got the belt from him. It was a 21-day reign.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. All right, Danny. Well,
that was,
well okay, yeah. But, well, great information.
Well, a lot of different quickies they did over the years.
So. Oh yeah. All right, well, we got to go, buddy. All right, well, we'll talk to you guys later. Thank you for joining me and checking us out. Have a good one. Thank you.
Thank you.